All right. Hello, everyone. Thanks, everyone, so much for coming out tonight to Aurora Picture Show. I know there's a lot happening tonight, and so I'm really thankful that you all are here with us tonight. We're thrilled to have Austin-based filmmaker PJ Raval here to discuss his work with HCAST's artistic director, Jessica Green, as part of both of Cinema Arts Festival and the Texas Biennial. Thank you to both for collaborating with Aurora Picture Show to bring this conversation to you all tonight. Aurora is in the middle of a membership drive. You probably saw our video at the beginning. And so we thank all of our members, and we encourage anyone who's interested in becoming a member to help support our program that we do year round. Our next and final program of the year is on December 11th. We'll be showing a new animated film by Houston artist Jiang Che. There's also going to be a free online conversation with Jiang and San Francisco-based artist Genevieve Quick on December 9th. So we hope that you'll join us for that. And now I'm going to turn it over to Jessica and PJ, so give them a warm welcome.
Hi, everybody. How are you guys doing tonight? Are you doing well? Really well. Okay, good. I like all the wind rustling. This, flora is really beautiful here. I just want to acknowledge the beautiful flora. Big round of applause for the beautiful flora and the wind rustling. So we get started. So I'm Jessica Green. I'm the artistic director of the Houston Cinema Arts Society and Festival. And I am so excited to be here with PJ, who is just an incredible human being who I've known for several years. Amazing filmmaker and educator, artist from a small town in California, Central California, who now lives and is now an Austin-based filmmaker, doing his thing, 50 different projects at once, has an incredible body of work. And I think what we're gonna do right is start with an intro from you. You wanted to give people just kind of like a foundational sense of what your work is about. So PJ is going to start and kind of just like set the stage for you guys, give you guys a foundation. And then we're going to look at some clips. We're going to talk in between the clips. We want to keep this really free flowing. So if you guys have questions, you know, I'll kind of stop in between clips also to kind of give you some time to ask your questions, just project, share them with us. We want this just to be a real conversation with, you know, all of us together. So I'm turning it over to PJ.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, thank you all for coming out, and thank you to Jessica and Mary and everyone at Aurora Picture Show. And it's a pleasure to be here. I don't really get a chance too much to come to Houston, but it's great to come here and experience it. And I came last night and was able to attend a little bit and just check everything out. It's been great. So thank you for being here. I love the idea of keeping this intimate. So yeah, for sure, if anyone has any questions, feel free to jump in. But for me, it's interesting because, you know, this is an opportunity to maybe reflect on me being a filmmaker. And I'll just start off and say that I never thought I would be a filmmaker. Let's just put that out there. You know, my parents come from the Philippines. I grew up, as Jessica mentioned, in a really small town in Central California, and it was just not in my awareness or perception that that was even a possibility. So it's kind of really amazing to actually, to be a filmmaker now. So so I grew up in this really small town, very conservative, very white, very not particularly accepting, right? So I think my early sense of self was very much rooted in this idea of being kind of an outsider, right? Like not quite fitting in, and kind of knowing that there was maybe, you know, other things happening also in the world elsewhere. And where I was at the time, not feeling completely, not even accepted is the right word, but maybe even acknowledged, right? So eventually, I started mostly making artwork. And I worked, and studied art for a little bit, and, eventually discovered photography, and then somehow through photography discovered filmmaking. And just really briefly, I was thinking about this morning, actually, is that I discovered filmmaking. just to give you a little bit more background, I wasn't the kid who watched everything and thought, and dreamed of being a filmmaker. I didn't actually pay that much attention, to be quite honest.
You were making Ghostbusters films in your backyard when you were 11 years old.
Okay. Yeah, you meet these filmmakers and you see these amazing films that they'd made much younger, and that was not me at all, when I was studying art, I took a film history class, and I actually fell in love with some films by, it sounds really nerdy, but Maya Darren, who's this experimental filmmaker. Yeah, and I really loved her. Yeah, thank you.
This
I really
is a Maya Darren crowd. Come on. Yeah, it's a big Maya shout Darren out for Maya crowd. Darren. There we go. Yeah.
Yeah, I just really loved her films, and I remember thinking I've never really thought of filmmaking like that before. Yeah. And mm-hmm. that, and then being in photography at the time, and that kind of, interested me in kind of exploring film. So I explored film in the whole 16 millimeter black and white kind of, that was my entry point into filmmaking. But anyway, what we're going to look at tonight is actually a collection of documentary work that I've made. And I was reminded earlier that, I have had a long history of filmmaking now, and I've made films in a lot of different ways. And I actually screened work at the Aurora Picture Show, I think it was maybe in 2008, 2009, somewhere around there. And when I screened the work, it was all short narrative and experimental work. Mm. And I even gave a talk about being queer and making work that kind of spoke to my queer identity. And so it's kind of interesting to be back here now and be talking about nonfiction and documentary work, which is where I started focusing things, 10 years later. Right. So it's kind of interesting. It's kind of coming full circle.
Yeah, and it makes a lot of sense, right? And that's a good setup, I think, for Trinidad, the first clip we're going to watch, right?
Sure.
Because we're speaking now to these aesthetic intersections that you represent, right? But there's also all of these personal and political intersections, right, that you're representing, and there's so many themes that you're exploring in your work. So just as we, go forward and look at the clips, especially think about this first one, yeah. I just want to encourage everybody to think about it as very foundational to, PJ's values, right, as an artist and as a filmmaker. And we're going to talk about that more as we look at stuff and think about also wow, this is part of the Texas Biennial, right? So this is about, and your family's from the Philippines, right? So this is about these histories, these shared histories, right, of imperialism and colonialism and histories of queerness and being a person of color and coming from a small town, and all of these kind of intersections are there in this artist that he then shares with the world and put out there in all this work. So that's just something thematically that I want you guys to think about, and how that is located, locally in this idea of Texas also,
yeah,
in the Biennial, and this idea of the Third Coast, right? This program, that's the theme for the festival,
yeah.
Third Coast. So just some things to think about. Anything you want to share about Trinidad besides that?
Yeah. So, as I mentioned, I was here last with short narrative and experimental films. I had never made a documentary. But I was also working largely as a cinematographer, and I started filming some nonfiction and documentary work. And I got really interested in it because it's just, people are amazing, right? And so meeting real people, getting to witness their stories, getting to capture them, there's a real power to that. And so I set out with a really good friend of mine named Jay Hodges to make a documentary. And I'd never really done that before, even though I had studied filmmaking. So what you're going to watch is a clip from the very first documentary I made. And I just jumped right in and made a feature documentary. Later, we'll actually see some short work. But I just started focusing on feature-length documentaries for a couple years. Long story short, my friend Jay and I, we were at a dinner party, and someone had mentioned that they had driven through Trinidad, Colorado. And if you're not familiar, Trinidad is a small town in the southern area of Colorado. And what they had discovered driving through it at the time is it was known as the quote-unquote sex change capital of the world. And I could not believe that. And this was, a town where, now we would call them gender reaffirming surgeries had started. And there was a lot of mythology about the town, that there was a lot of transgender individuals in the town. And having come from a small town in Central California, it was really hard for me to imagine that happening. I think I had always assumed this was happening in these kind of liberal meccas of the United States, like San Francisco, Los Angeles, New York. And so the fact that it was occurring in this small kind of country western town in Colorado really fascinated myself and my friend Jay. So we set out there to make a documentary, and I think we're going to see a clip from that film.
And we're ready.
Well, the patients of Dr. Biber, when they were ready to leave the hospital, they would ask me, can you take this guy down to the Best Western Motel? And I said, sure, I'll take him down there. And I talked to him just like I do the rest of the tourists on here, you know.
You can't really say, oh, geez, look, there's a transsexual. Most of the time you can't tell.
Oh, you know, I think truthfully they blend in. There are points when maybe they're first getting started where, you know, it's definitely that you can tell there's a difference.
I've probably run into one maybe in the last year. I was checking into the hospital and there was this girl in front of me checking in the hospital. I thought she was a hell of a good looking girl.
I'd say a good 10 years ago, it blew my mind. I was working in a gas station and one of the so-called patients came in to buy gas and he could spot it right away. It was obvious.
Occasionally they come in here and have dinner. I think maybe sometimes people may just say, oh, you know, they look more manly or something, but you know, how can we say? I don't know, you know?
A lot of them would come in the shop and get their hair done and their nails done. And, you know, the majority of them kind of stand out. You kind of know. And if they look a little different and they're trying to wear female clothing or whatever, you kind of already know.
We've seen one that has a real tacky wig. We've seen one that needs a fashion update.
One of these days, she's going to walk by and I'm going to yank them in and give them some... some tips on fashion etiquette.
There are some that are bigger, you know, but you do find some women too that are women that are, you know, have a bigger bone structure also.
I feel pretty comfortable because I've had a couple incidents where, you know, they want to really get into the details. Some of them have tried to, you know, even want to show me, but I...
Do I consider them women?
Mm-hmm.
No. I don't consider them women until that's what they say they are.
Shouldn't fool with Mother Nature. That's my opinion, though. I believe a man's a man, a woman's a woman, and whatever else, they keep that secluded from the world, anyway.
I don't know what makes these people do what they do. I don't know what makes anybody do what they want to do. But, you know, it doesn't matter what a person does, what choices they have, but everyone has something screwed up in their head that makes them decisions for them.
People are prejudiced. Duke's mixture, right? And it's just something that people have to not be.
Get over it.
Right. Not be. Everybody's created equal. It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm.
We all bleed the same color blood. We're all on the inside the same person. Nobody can tell you any different because they don't know.
We're starting to sound like preachers.
Oh, I know.
I think we have more transgenders in Trinidad than people actually realize. They have feelings, they have families, they have children, they have wants and desires just like every other person on God's green earth, and they're just people, human beings.
Us. Sorry, that was out of sync. That is not the house. That was probably my fault, actually.
Yeah. Well, we'll get it right the next time.
No yeah. Worries. Yeah,
Is there anything you wanted to say after we watched the clip? Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting watching that. I mean, I started filming that in 2004, so it's been a minute. And as I mentioned, I never really made a documentary before. but I had worked on some. And, you know, my friend Jay and I, when we discovered that, you know, Trinidad had this history to it, we had also discovered at the time that, you know, there was a pioneer surgeon, Dr. Stanley Biber, they kind of mentioned him briefly in there, who in the 60s, you know, kind of was a pioneer surgeon and started creating, or, you know, started offering these surgeries that eventually, you know, today has now become, you know, gender affirmation surgery. But when we started looking at this in 2004, he was, I forget how old he was at the time, but he was getting up there and he was passing on his practice to Dr. Marcy Bowers, who also identifies of having a transgender history. She identifies as a woman and identifies as having a transgender history. So that was very fascinating to us. So the film actually centers largely around Marcy, Dr. Marcy Bowers, and her practice there and several of her former and current patients who moved to the town in this effort to try to create this you know, transgender community. But the section that we just watched, you know, I also treated the town as a character in itself. And I was very interested in, you know, looking at kind of these American archetypes, right? Like, so we have like the postal worker, you know, the women in the bridal shop, you know, the men at the, you know, at the garage and the mechanic and these kind of ideas that we have of the United States and small towns and kind of archetypes of gender, right? And I just wanted to ask them what it was like to kind of live in Trinidad. And we extended that into the film itself where at some point we interview kids, right? In the school, in the elementary school and junior high, and just start asking them these questions about gender and trying to get a sense of when our sense of self of gender actually starts occurring. And you start seeing in like younger kids versus like the older kids, you know, by the time they start becoming young adults, how it goes from, you know, their concepts of gender being playing with, you know, cars versus dolls to ideas of strength and beauty and, you know, these physical attributes. So for me, making Trinidad, I think I started realizing that I was really interested in looking at kind of, you know, these communities, right, where you have certain individuals who are kind of viewed as outsiders, right, and how it challenges and causes these communities to, I don't want to say question their value, but maybe, you know, maybe think more about just kind of the, you know, the ideas that they've grown up with, right?
Yeah, and I think what we should do is set up the next clip and then have Kate questions after that, because sure. I think there's some linkages, you know, and what you just said, right, about around Before You Know It.
Yeah.
Right, this film about queer elders, right?
Mm-hmm.
Could you, you know, what do you think about that idea in terms of, you know, and even like the idea of archetypes. Are there
sure.
archetypes in Before You Know It?
Yeah.
You
know, so I released Trinidad in 2008 and I ended up screening it at the Woodstock Film Festival, right, in upstate New York. And there was a reception that was thrown for the film, which was amazing. And it was at the Kingston LGBTQ Community Center. And at the community center, when I walked in, I would say maybe 75%, if not more, were individuals over 80. Mm-hmm. And they were all LGBTQ, right? And so it was really interesting as someone who was not walking into the space, and I don't think I had ever really been in a space before where the majority of the population there identified as seniors. Mm-hmm. And certainly there were a few 20-year-old, you know, trans individuals, but these were you know, community members who were 80 plus. And I just, you know, started walking around and talking to them, thanking them for doing the reception. And I started hearing all these amazing stories about, you know, people who had lovers who had died during the AIDS crisis, right? People who had just recently come out, you know, at the age of like 80, you know, and people who were really just reeling with the ideas of, you know, gay marriage, like all of these things that they never saw happening in their lifetime. So I started really thinking about how, even my identity as a queer individual, never really thinking of aging, the aging communities, and how these particular people that I were meeting really are a piece of history that had been overlooked. And if we don't start looking at their stories, they might disappear, right? So I set out to make a feature documentary called Before You Know It. Mm-hmm. And we follow three gay men, one who lives in Florida and is closeted at the time, and then eventually moves to Portland and comes out, and also comes out as a crossdresser. And then we follow one couple in Harlem, Ty Martin, who I think we're going to see a clip from.
Yes.
And he's a organizer, you know, and community activist, working.
Still doing his thing.
Still
right?
doing yeah, his thing. Still working his for thing. SAGE, which is Services and Advocacy for GLBT Elders. And he's someone who, when gay marriage passes in New York, is suddenly thrown into this, you know, crisis of thinking, like, is he going to get married? Is his partner ever going to propose to him? Like, you know, what's going to happen? And then I follow one story actually in Galveston, which is not too far from here, where I look at the owner of Robert's Lafitte's. If any of you have been there, which is one of my favorite places in Texas in general. You know, he's a bar owner and started this bar and, you know, created this amazing community. So kind of the three of them together, I was really thinking about looking at, you know, in a strange way, kind of like a life cycle. We have one character who's coming out at the age of 80. We have another character who's dealing with, you know, partnership and marriage. And then we have another person who's thinking about kind of legacy, right? And this idea of building this amazing community and what happens when, you know, you're going to pass on, and where, what's going to happen to this community. So, yeah, so perhaps we can see this clip.
Yeah, Before You Know It.
How many people here live alone?
Yeah, most people.
Right. And is that by preference, or you just can't find anybody?
Preference.
When I was younger, I always wanted my boyfriends to live with me, but now I don't care. You, if I ever get another one, you have your place, I'll have mine. Because I just don't want to be bothered, you know, like that anymore.
I know that today, a friend is far more important than any imaginary lover or wannabe knight in shining armor.
And my brother's over here together 30 years, you say? That's
but the Michaels are very unique.
Yeah. Oh, no, they're not. That's why I like this business about protect marriage, you know. I always think, wouldn't it be nice if we'll pass a law that outlaws divorce? Uh-huh. Because that will protect marriage, right, won't it?
Actually, yes, it would. It's true, but they have no choice. They have no choice.
I feel very blessed to have a significant other. You know, I've had many friends who died alone, and there was no one there to witness it until after the fact. I try not to wonder what would happen with my life if Stanton expires 5 minutes from now.
Nice. So let's open it up. Any questions for PJ? We're two clips in. Any thoughts, folks, audience members? Don't be shy. Questions, comments?
Do I have to repeat that? Everyone heard that, right? For the most part? Yeah. So would they say the same things? I don't think they would. You know, I mean, as I mentioned, I filmed this in 2004, you know, it released in 2008, it's, you know, now in 2021, there's been such a huge amount of education that has happened, a huge amount of representation, right? You know, the fact that there's major programming on primetime television and platforms like Netflix, where you have openly identifying transgender individuals, you know, who are leading things. I think the awareness of the whole country, right? American culture has grown greatly. So no, I don't think going back to Trinidad, people would probably say the same things. There might be a few people who do, but I think there would also be other people who probably have a lot more awareness now. Yeah.
I'd like to hear you talk about your training in the dramatic structure in documentary, please.
Sure. Yeah, my training in dramatic structure. So, I studied art mostly, and I was heavily rooted in kind of more conceptual, kind of like more conceptual art theory, which doesn't sound very interesting. But then I started studying film. So the way that I came to Texas was I actually went to graduate school at University of Texas at Austin. And there I definitely studied more in terms of dramatic structure and thinking about, you know, three-act structure and the way that people understand narratives. So it's mostly kind of my background. I mean, it's interesting now, and we'll, you know, as we move forward and see some clips, you'll see that my work has definitely become more in also an investigative journalist kind of sphere. And I'm not a trained journalist, and I don't come from that background, but I think as I've started working more in documentary, I've started thinking a lot more about how documentaries function and what kind of areas they also touch upon. And certainly journalism, you know, investigative reporting is part of that as well. You know, these elements that are kind of unfolding. And so it goes into that as well. But I think at the end of the day, a lot of it always goes down to me thinking about character. I'm really drawn by, I mean, hopefully just from the two clips alone, you can see I'm really drawn by characters, by people, right? So most of my films, if not all of my films, center around someone's personal experience. And that's how I often, you know, I'm really interested and inspired by making film. I'm inspired by people.
Yeah, and I just want to acknowledge that it's that rootedness in character, right, combined with this, like, interest and passion about social history, you know, and social change that makes your film so organic, you know, and natural and holistic. And, you know, I think it's, you know, because, yeah, you're interested in what's going on, but you're rooted in these, like, real people and who they are and really making sure audiences get to know them, you know, and that makes, you know, so it's like a lot of your films, I feel like, fall into this category of, like, let's revisit, let's talk about 15 years later, like, how things are different, you know, and the next film is a good example of that. Yeah. Call Urganda is definitely, you know, what would happen in the Philippines now, or, you know, around the situation, how things might be different or not.
Sure.
And yeah, so, you know, I'm a huge fan of Call Urganda.
Oh,
I think it's, you know, just this film, we're going to watch a clip from Call Urganda. I want you to talk about it, but I would just say, you know, how can people check it out online right now, Call Urganda?
It's on a lot of platforms.
It's on a lot of platforms,
yeah,
that's what I thought.
Yeah.
It's on a lot of platforms, look for it.
Yeah.
This documentary is really singular. It's doing a lot of different things, and when I talk about intersections, this film really speaks to just all of these different themes that PJ is balancing, all these different ideas around gender, around politics, around the Philippines' own Trump, you know, Duarte, and just, I mean, it's just all of these different things, and you're just threading it together so beautifully, and this investigative journalist that you follow, that is Meredith, right, who's such an incredible character. When you talk about character, she is a great character and person to follow. She was so compelling, you're so rooting for her, and that you root this huge story about colonialism and mercantilism and you know, anti, you know, trans bias and all this stuff in this very compelling character. So powerful. So please, share whatever else. You know.
Sure. Yeah. You know, a lot of the films that I'm making, you know, they don't come across as personal probably because I'm not in them, right? We think a personal documentary usually, you know, the person being also kind of the protagonist in the film or having, you know, some kind of presence, and I'm not. But realistically, all of these films are personal to me somehow, right? So with Trinidad specifically, you know, I was thinking a lot about, you know, identifying as a queer individual, but not, you know, at the time, especially in 2004, myself really thinking through people that I had met who were identifying as trans and really trying to understand that, you know, in terms of gender identity, gender expression, all of those kinds of things. And then before you know it, for me, it really was thinking about, you know, aging and future and how, for me, part of being in a queer community, I do think there's a lot of, you know, assumptions around aging specifically, and not thinking about it, right? And in a lot of ways, in queer communities, it can almost even be worse, right? There's a lot of value placed upon youth, and this idea of seeing older individuals, like maybe in certain spaces and no longer being seen, right? And so I was thinking a lot about that. And then at some point I started thinking a lot about just kind of my identity as a Filipino American. You know, as I mentioned, my family comes from the Philippines and I grew up in the United States. And I think I started realizing, so the area that I grew up in, Central California, just briefly, it's an area that has actually some very significant history to Filipino American history. The area that I grew up in, there was someone named Larry Itliong, right? And if you're not familiar, Larry Itliong, along with Cesar Chavez, started this whole Delano grape strike, right? And really started kind of the labor movement, right? Which we can really attribute to now. And, you know, he was of Filipino descent. And the fact that I grew up so close to that area and knew nothing about this, right? Knew nothing about my own history as someone Filipino American growing up in this area, I think speaks volumes to my experience growing up, right? Like, so much of history has not been focused on certain individuals and really thinking about the United States and its relationship to the Philippines. And how I am the result of that, right? Like, my family comes here, I grew up in the United States, and I don't know anything about it. So I started getting very interested in the Philippines, and and I was fortunate enough to be invited to go there and screen some of my previous work. And when I was there, this is in 2014, I used it as an opportunity to also, acquaint myself with the queer community that was there. So not only was I meeting filmmakers, but I was also meeting LGBT organizers and community members. And at the time, people were really outraged because Jennifer Laude, who is a trans woman in the Philippines, had just been murdered and found dead. And there was information that was starting to come out that she was last seen with an American, someone who was white, and then it turned out that he was a U.S. Marine. So I happened to be there at the time, and I ended up on a panel for about LGBT rights alongside some of the kind of key players, including Attorney Virginia Suarez, who is the family lawyer who represents the Laude family. And I met the family, and I ended up making a film about it. And so I think we're going to watch a clip about that.
A very, 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 very good film.
Thank you.
Thank you.
clip.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a really heavy film, as you can imagine.
But such a beautiful tribute to her.
Thank you.
And also really, I think, expresses and shares her character. I get a really good sense of who she was from the film, which is one of the things I most appreciate about it.
Yeah.
It really honors her.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting, you know, making this film about, you know, up until that point, I had made films about people that I was following, and now I was making a film about someone who I had actually never met, right? And I'm only meeting her through her loved ones, right, and people who knew her. And in the film, I follow three women, you know, one who's an investigative journalist, who is kind of breaking the story and you know, reporting on it, and one of the few people who reported upon it. But she's also, you know, born and raised in the Philippines, also trans. And then I follow Jennifer's mom, who we see in the clip here with her family, who, if you can imagine, is someone who did not formally go to school, you know, so largely from a lot of people's understanding would be, you know, quote unquote, uneducated officially. But she, you know, really, you know, when this happened, she really stepped up and was very outspoken and vocal about the injustice that happened. And then I follow the, you know, the third character is, the lawyer who is, you know, fighting the case in the courtroom. So kind of looking at those three stories together. And we also look at the history a little bit of just kind of U.S. colonialism in the Philippines and how that's kind of tied to and mirrors very much the kind of oppression of trans and gender non-binary individuals in the Philippines.
Yeah. Yeah, while also following these really inspiring characters like Meredith, you know, who, I mean, it really shows her kind of utilizing all of this literacy and access that she has, right, to obtain information while also just practicing, like, the most hardcore, like, journalistic investigative reporting, like, yeah. Demonstrating just, like, such hardcore skills as an investigative reporter. And I just think, like, the modeling in this amazing trans kick-ass character, you know, who's just so fierce and fearless, is just like, it's amazing. She's so cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So any questions at this point? Anything? Any thoughts? Questions? Call or got? Yeah.
And regarding your first, let me just show train of that. It seems like you have an intent. The intent is to educate in a positive way. But have you had any negative results from making this film? Unintended results?
For me personally, or just reactions?
Just from exposing Trinidad and that clinic, did anybody come to the hospital or the clinic and try to do anything to hurt any of the trans people or the person that's actually doing the operations?
Yeah, I don't think so, and if so, I don't think it was necessarily the film that did that. I mean, specifically thinking about Marcy, who I think you're asking about from, you know, Trinidad, she had had a certain amount of attention around her, regardless, you know, of the film. There are definitely journalists who are interested, and I think in general she received probably a certain amount of, and probably still does to this day, of negative comments, you know, hateful comments, and definitely deals with that. And actually, if you end up watching the film at some point, in her time there, she someone writes an anonymous letter to the newspaper saying that they don't want the practice there, they don't believe this holds the value. And then over the next couple weeks, she watches the newspaper and all these other town people write in, right, and say, like, live and let live, like, why are you, you know, we should love one another and that kind of thing. And for me, that was really amazing because it really showed how I think the town viewed itself, right? You know, when it was being challenged. So, but to be quite honest, all the work that I make receives a certain amount. I mean, maybe this is not what you're asking, but I think just being a queer person of color in the United States, making work that has content that's queer and or people of color, like I myself receive a certain amount of negative and, you know, hate and, you know, terrible comments. And it's one of those things that I think just we as individuals probably experience this in our daily lives, right? Whether it be some kind of microaggression or some kind of outward, you know, someone trying to take away our rights in some way, form or fashion and who they think we are, right? So I certainly am not, you know, protected from that at all, you know, and as a filmmaker being visible about it, you know, I definitely receive that also. So same with the people I think in the film to a certain extent. But I don't know, I can't really say if I think there's anything more because of that. So even the clip that we watched, like Jennifer's mom, she ended up being on every news channel in the Philippines. And certainly there was a lot of social media talking about, you know, the family being greedy or they don't really care, you know, this and that. And so, yeah, so I think they did experience a certain amount of hate from you know, anonymous people. Sadly, yeah. But I do think, you know, but for me, one of the things I'm very interested in doing, you know, with my films is thinking about the impact that they are going to have. And I hope people are educated through them. And not even so much educated, but I hope people empathize with the people in the film, right? And I do think that's why I'm drawn to filmmaking in general, right? When I was doing other art forms, I think maybe what was missing for me was I do think filmmaking as a form of storytelling is really powerful because I think you're allowed to sit with someone for a certain amount of time and you start feeling like you're experiencing what they're experiencing. And in that process of, I do think though someone maybe has never been to the Philippines, they don't know anything about the trans community there, they don't know anything about how long, you know, the Navy and the US Marines have been in the Philippines, but they do understand this concept of loss. They do understand this concept of feeling powerless against something larger than you. And in the process of understanding that and experiencing it, I think it connects people, right? And you start understanding how someone's experience you can relate to, even though you never thought you could, right? You know, thinking about Before You Know It, what was really interesting about Before You Know It, you know, as I mentioned, it was three older gay men, all in their, like, you know, anywhere from 65 to, like, 90. Oftentimes when I would screen that film, I would have young women come up to me, young cisgender women come up to me and say how much they identified with the characters there. And it was really interesting. It was completely unexpected, but I really think it just shows that, like, you know, that power of seeing someone's experience and understanding the commonalities you have with someone.
Do you think that that ability to understand the commonalities is a big part of how you're able to do this work and have this practice through, you know, difficulties or through pushback or through, you know, dealing with people that don't understand? Because I just feel like, again, like your work, it's almost like, here's social change. It's like this swirling thing, right? And your work is just like going in it and out of it, you know what I mean? As it's like swirling around and you're making a film about something and then 10 years later, like the attitudes about this thing that you made a film about have like completely changed, you know? And like, how do you navigate that and take care of yourself? Because there must be, you know, so much pushback. Is it through that, like finding those connections, those ways that you're finding those entry points and how we all connect?
Yeah, that's a great question, right? Self-care. I do think, you know, selfishly, I am making a lot of these films because it's me also just working through things, you know, yeah. Things that I want to think about, things. I don't go into anything thinking I'm an expert in any means. If anything, I'm usually completely not an expert about whatever I'm looking at. And that's partially why I'm trying to look at it, is I have a genuine interest and I'm curious about something and I feel something and I just, you know, intuitively am feeling like this is something that I should focus on, and for whatever reason, and I always come out of it a very different person, right? And I grow alongside, you know, the film as it's being made, and I learn from it, and I'm educated in the process of doing it. I experience something different, and you know, because of that, they become personal in different ways. But it's also a trajectory of my growth, if that makes any sense. So even watching the films, I'm like, oh yeah, I remember thinking this is how I thought, and now I'm connecting these new ideas, right? So in the process of, even though I might be making some things that, and specifically with this last film, Call Her Gunda, very heavy, right? You know, looking at trauma, looking at death, looking at violence. I think for me, they really help me understand the world, right? And understand myself in the world in these strange ways. So, so yeah, even though I think they are difficult subjects, mm-hmm. I think I'm growing from them. So it makes it, I don't want to say it makes it easy, but it allows me to keep working kind of in that way.
Yeah, that makes sense. Can you share anything about Come and Take It before we watch that?
Yeah. Yeah. This one's a fun one. It's, you know, as I mentioned, we're looking at my documentary work. I also make a lot of music videos and queer performance art videos, and I often do that because I am making this work that is much longer in time to make and also very demanding in a lot of ways emotionally, and so I'm always balancing it out with making some things that are really like short and fun and, you know, maybe even crazy and really, you know, and around the time that I was making this film, Call Her Gunda, you know, I teach at the University of Texas at Austin. Campus carry had just passed. If you're not familiar, campus carry is the law that allows concealed firearms to be brought onto a university campus, right? So as this was happening, I was also watching the reactions to it occur, not only as someone who was a faculty member, but from the students and the, you know, the younger generation at the university. And I got very interested in Jessica Jin, who is a Chinese-American recent graduate of the University of Texas at Austin, and she, you know, pointed out the fact that it was that it was legal to bring a concealed firearm onto a university campus, but it was illegal, right, and a misdemeanor to bring on a sex toy to the university campus, you know, specifically looking at dildos. Right. So on the first day of school, when this law had just passed, she got 4,000 sex toys donated to her, and she passed it out, and she created a Facebook event called called Dildo Carry. Right. And it was this idea that she was going to point out the absurdity of this situation. But from a more serious note, the things that I loved about it is she was also pointing out how we as a culture, and I'm saying we here in the United States, right, culturally have kind of normalized guns and, you know, firearms, but very much are still afraid of anything that's sex oriented, right? And I just love
pervasively so
right
in our media and everything, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I just love the fact that this was being you know, brought to the attention specifically in Austin by young women, right? Led by Jessica Jin. So I think we're going to see a clip from a short film that I made. So as I mentioned, I had made feature documentaries, and then with this, I decided, oh, I'm going to make a short film, and you know, I made it with a friend, Ellen Spiro, who also was teaching at the university at the time. So I think we're going to see a clip of this short film called Come and Take It.
Who decided this was a good idea? Jessica Jin!
Hi, it seems that I have cracked an enormous dick joke on the internet. Strap it on, deal with the discomfort, deal with the weird looks, because that's the way people should be treating gun culture in America. So wear it loud, wear it proud, don't apologize for it, and don't take them off until people take their guns home.
Come on!
That's a lot of dildos.
It is. Yeah, I mean 4,000, yeah, if you can imagine.
Where did the 4,000? Do you know who donated the 4,000? I'm just curious.
I forget.
Does one get 4,000 dildos donated?
Yeah, I mean we were filming her when she was getting them, and it was just boxes and boxes, okay, and you know, and putting out. You know, she was. Yeah. You know, asking people to take them home, handing them out the first day. But yeah, I really admire what she did, and I think for me, you know, part of the reason why I wanted to make this is I had been making films outside of Texas, and I live here. You know, and I was like, I really should be looking at what's happening locally, right? And thinking about what are some of the things happening. And I just loved, for me, this is also. Kind of a lesson of like younger generations, right? Because at the time there had been all these conversations from, you know, faculty members about, you know, how to protest this and, you know, how to stop this. And then you have Jessica just come out of nowhere, right? And do this and really bring a certain visibility and change the conversation, right? And really, yeah, change that conversation. And I think there was something really fresh about her approach, but really grounded, you know. And I know it's very sensational, but really when you speak with her, she's so smart, and she has, you know, her story is really inspirational, actually.
Nice. Audience questions? Any questions before we go to the next clip? Well, I have a question.
Sure.
Yeah, because this is a good segue. I mean, Austin, UT, you know, film school, graduate film school. Like, where does that fall? Like, what is the importance of that? What is the place of that in terms of your journey? What is the place of the film community in Austin? How important is that to the work that you're doing, that education, and then that program there, you know, being so strong? Could you just talk a little bit about that? And
yeah you know, that's kind of where I, you know, a lot of my, you know, film education came from. And then, so as I mentioned earlier, I went to graduate school there, and then I left, right? Mm-hmm. And I, you know, was working largely as a cinematographer for a number of years. I was making, you know, these other films. So I've always been directing and producing my own work, and was also working. And then I got offered a position. So I moved back to Austin in, I think it was 2011, maybe 2011, 2012, somewhere around there, moved back. And it's interesting, to be honest, I didn't really put much thought into it other than, you know, selfishly I thought to myself, oh, this will be a great way for me to get more work done. I'll be able to sit down and really focus on getting some work. And I like teaching, you know, it's fun. But now I think I have a different view about it, because if you can imagine, I mean, for anyone who does teach, you know, you do have students, right? You know, you have students that you're teaching, and the idea of I'm their instructor, you know, I'm the one teaching them, I think, you know, also surprises me, right? Because I grew up thinking that filmmakers were these white heterosexual Steven Spielbergs, right? And then someone can come to a university and take a class with me, right? And I'm making films like this, you know? And so there's something that has become fulfilling teaching in a lot of ways that I didn't expect at all, that I myself, as someone, as a figure, right?
And where you were a student.
Where I was a student, yeah. Right, can maybe have some kind of impact that I was not really thinking about, you know? So that part's been really fun,
yeah.
You know? And I do have, you know, I have had students, for instance, who have, you know, taken my classes, and they've come out in my classes because maybe they've never met someone who, you know, was queer and open about it and talking about certain things. I've started noticing that my classes, as I started teaching, started getting much more equal mixture of men and women, you know, BIPOC students, and that's really great. You know, it's very fulfilling to, you know, to see that.
Well, they're really lucky to have you.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, so let's set up Sugar Pie de Santo.
Yeah, so these are fun. So this summer, when COVID hit, a lot of filmmakers, you know, weren't able to make a lot of work. I, on the other hand, kind of like really increased the amount of work. And one of the things I did was I made two films for this cultural campaign called CS Unite. And it's a cultural campaign that's looking at Asian Americans in solidarity, specifically with other Black and Brown communities, right? So I made two micro documentaries that were executive produced by Renee Tajima Pena, who's an amazing filmmaker who made Who Killed Vincent Chin, which is an amazing film, and Jeff Chang, who is a culture writer.
Amazing writer.
Yeah, an amazing writer. And so together they partnered with Four Freedoms and they made this cultural campaign. And so I made two short documentaries and we're going to watch one right now, which is fun because I'd never made anything this short. It's like 2.5 minutes, I think. And it's about Sugar Pie DeSanto, who I'm not going to say much more about because you'll learn about her.
One palaya. I say palaya, but it should be umpalaya, which is a bitter melon or sour fruit in Filipino. So I have a mixed name, Pinoy. And so, my father is a Filipino born from Manila, and my mother was a soul sister from Philadelphia. My dad couldn't hold a tune in the bucket. But my mother was a very good pianist. That's who taught me how to sing. But the only thing about that is, it was all whitery songs, you know, until I started visiting my girlfriend's house. Then I started hearing the soul. What is that? That maybe I can do it. I grew up in Fillmore. To me, it was a special neighborhood for me. Because, you know, they played all them blues and all. Where I was living, it was fully mixed with everything. German, Chinese, Mexican, Black, whatever. We just lived together, period, and learned to respect each other, that's that. My cousin is the famous Eddie James, you know. We just grew up together, and we sit on the back porch and sing and harmonize. I know, that's party time in the basement. Back in the day, you couldn't get in the living room with your family and everything, you know, so we'd go down in the basement, you know, and party. You know, a lot of fun. That's Etta. Yeah, we're doing a duet. I think music can bring you together. It can uplift you. Just appreciate how far I've come, you know, and I want to go further.
I told you to watch this.
Take care out there. Don't forget about me. Sugar Pie DeSanto, worldwide entertainer, international.
That is so much fun.
Yeah, she's great. She's amazing. You should listen to her music. It's really good.
Yeah, I want to open it up, but you described that as a micro documentary.
Micro documentary.
So can you talk a little bit about the different structural choices, the different choices you make for a feature versus a micro documentary?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, with a feature length, especially if it's, you know, over an hour or even close to an hour, like you have a certain amount of time to, you know, really have a story play out. And with something that's 2.5 minutes long, you really don't, right? So it's kind of like a snapshot. So for me, I approached it as, you know, who is Sugar Pie DeSanto? It's, you know, she's the most amazing performer that you may not have known about, and I'm going to give you all the highlights very quickly, you know? And hopefully, you know, by the end of this, you will be curious and want to know more about Sugar Pie DeSanto and listen to her music or look her up or something, right? And now that you know her. So, you know, it's more of like just giving the kind of like essence, right?
I want to know about the like stories of her and Etta James hanging out. Oh my God. That must have been wild. Okay, questions, comments. Audience, questions, comments.
Did you do the micro documentaries done for hire kind of scenario, or did you just like around for it?
No, it was, yeah. It was, you know, Renee Tajima-Pena and Jeff Chang, they hired several filmmakers, and they approached me and said, yeah, if you'd like to do one. And I was like, sure, yeah, this sounds fun, you know. You know, they knew that I was also interested in, you know, looking at stories and, you know, people connected to Philippines heritage. And so Sugar Pie, you know, kind of came to mind. I was like, yes, I will totally make something, you know, about Sugar Pie.
Yeah, and the correct title is Who Killed Vincent Chin, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of like the Bible, the like, the holy grail for like Asian American bias story. I mean, it's such an incredible film. And maybe just share a little about that for people that aren't familiar.
Sure, yeah. So Renee Tajima-Pena, who made Who Killed Vincent Chin, it was actually a lot of inspiration that I drew from it for Call Her Gun Deb, which is,
no doubt.
You know, Who Killed Vincent Chin? Vincent Chin, if you're not familiar, was... you know, working in the auto and car industry in Detroit. And it was around the time that there was a lot of opposition happening from Japanese and Asian car companies that were coming in. So there was a lot of anti-Asian sentiments.
In the 80s.
In the 80s, yeah. And Vincent Chin, sadly, was killed by two men who he got into a bar fight with. And they, you know, they got into a fight in the bar, and then later they tracked him down and killed him. And it became a big rallying cry to Asian American communities to really understand, you know, violence and hate and anti-Asian violence, right? And for me, what was amazing about it is this case really brought into this idea of civil rights for Asian American communities, right? And if you get a chance to watch this film, it's an incredible film, and it really follows the, you know, the case as it's unfolding, but it also follows the family, Vincent Chin's mother, right? And you see her, you know, as an immigrant woman, you know, making statements and trying to, you know, get some kind of accountability. So when I was making Call Her Ganda, it was definitely something that I was keeping in mind, and how films can really capture, right, something historical and also be a reference point for this is when, you know, I don't want to say it's when the Asian American civil rights movement started, but it certainly added to it, right? And it was really powerful. So Renee is someone who I've looked up to as a filmmaker. And so, of course, when she said, oh, hey, do you want to work on this? I was like, yes, of course, I'll work on this.
and how art and media can inspire social change.
Yeah,
I mean, I think the film itself, you know, even beyond, is part of the reason why, right? And had this influence on the movement, and is a really good example of storytelling as a tool for social change.
Absolutely.
I mean, that film had so much impact, and I think really inspired the movement also while documenting it as well.
And honestly, that was the idea behind the CS Unite campaign, right, is the idea of making these micro-documentaries that would show, because as we know, there's a lot of intentional division that's sowed between communities of color, right? So there's always this intentional, like, let's break Asian Americans away from Black communities or Latinx communities, right? Because they know that together the communities are really powerful, right? So one way to disempower is to divide. So Renee and Jeff, you know, their idea was the CS Unite, like trying to show examples of solidarity, right? Whether it be historical or ongoing or present day. So I think we're going to see another clip from, are we seeing another?
The next one was Queer.
Yeah, so that's also from the series. Yeah, so I made another one for the series as well, and I think we're going to see this one next, which is about, keeping up this idea of solidarity.
Yes. All right, so let's cue it up.
Yeah. To 2 days from now, on May 12th, 1989, I found out that I was HIV positive.
Wow.
And I was told I wouldn't live to see 30. You know, many of us weren't expected to survive to this point, so we didn't think there would be anything about intergenerational.
For so many queer and trans people, I think we're told we do not have legacy and we do not have future. I had to live so much of my life as an individual person struggling to survive. Having intergenerational community has given me family.
My peers, they still say these things. Young people need to know what we went through, know what we fought for, and they need to respect us. And I'm like, why do they need to do that? You sound like their parents, you know?
You've always been so curious and just open to embracing things as possibility. How are you like this?
Well, you know, I had a partner. Mm-hmm. And in some ways, I still think he is my partner, even though he passed. And I used to start everything with, in my experience, and one day Jesse just goes to me, Vince, there is so much more to AIDS than your pathetic experience. So can you just quit saying that? And I just looked and I was kind of shocked. I was like, oh, is this where we break up?
Whoa.
And he's like, you know, you need to think in terms of possibility. Hmm. Think about what you can do in the time that's been allotted to you, as opposed to what you can't do, and focus on that.
One of the only things that has kept me working at the intersection of queer and trans and Asian American Pacific Islander, even despite things feeling everlastingly difficult, is actually having these connections, because it's through these connections that I can talk with people and be like, yeah, you've been doing this work for 30 years and there's been like plenty of hard things, but also so many stories of joy.
And maybe this is the message, is that as we meet with younger people, we heal because we know that those efforts weren't for nothing.
Mm. I think part of intergenerational solidarity is making the space for people to release the pain and the hurt so that we can actually reach that vision of where we want to go together. I don't just see the things that I'm doing as one-year goals or five-year goals. I have to frame my work with urgency, but also with patience, understanding that impact continues to show up well after the program, the campaign, the rally has ended.
Yeah. Thank you.
It's beautiful.
Thanks. Yeah, so that was, so that was one of the other micro docs that I made, and, you know, thinking of this idea of solidarity, intergenerational solidarity, right? The idea, and so I had the idea of having Vince and Sammy just have a conversation about it, right? And see what it looks like to have that solidarity there, not only in conversation, but active listening, right? Not passive listening, but active listening, right? And really understanding someone's story, taking it in, and, you know, and reflecting, and that's kind of what came out of it. They loved it so much, we actually made a 10-minute version of the film. Mm. So if anyone's ever curious, they just released it online this last month, I think.
Mm. Yeah, it's beautiful. Any questions? Oh, we got one.
So it just occurred to me that, you know, one of the things about Asian culture, from my understanding, is this that differs from a lot of other cultures, is this huge respect, deep respect for elders. And seeing this clip and the film is like, can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Yeah. You know, something that's very familiar.
Coming from the most baby-faced elder like ever here.
Thank you.
Although you're not really an elder. Yeah, you're just baby-faced.
I'm so. An elder to some,
to
I'll say
some,
that
yeah,
much.
Yeah.
There's a term that, in the Philippines, we have a term called kuya, which means like older brother, and like you would say ate for like older sister. And we kind of use these terms, just like if you meet someone older or younger, right, you call them. And I went out the other night with some friends, and they were calling one of the, one of the other friends kuya. And I was like, I think you need to call me Kuya, because I was like, I'm much older than you, but they didn't see that. But anyway, yeah.
Baby face.
Baby face. Yeah, but what I was going to say is in Asian American cultures, I think multi-generational households are very common. You know, maybe not as much as, you know, in American culture, though certainly there are, but I think in Asian cultures there's a lot of emphasis played upon the aging process and respect to, you know, the elders. And it's kind of interesting, I was telling a friend about this the other day, that it's true. I think somehow, I mean, and you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do think in American culture there's a lot of emphasis on youth, right? So someone has a baby, it's all about the baby, not about the grandparents. And I do feel like, at least when I've been around other Asian cultures, it's usually the reverse. There's a lot of emphasis around, you know, here's so-and-so, you know, uncle so-and-so, grandma, you know, all these kinds of things. And, you know, what can we learn from them? So this respect for, you know, generations, right? And I think specifically, I've been doing a lot of work with Asian American filmmakers. So I sit on a leadership team for a network called Asian American Documentary Network. And one of our things is thinking about mentorship and this idea of having exchange between emerging filmmakers and more established filmmakers, and this idea of passing knowledge down and trying to build these kind of bridges so everyone can kind of learn from each other.
Yeah, shout out to that group. You guys are doing really good work.
Thank you. Yeah, it's called ADOC, if anyone's curious. But
yeah, really impressive. They're doing a lot of really impressive field building work, for sure. And yeah, we're going to set up the final clip, but I also just wanted to, because we were talking about the team behind these last two projects, you know, we were talking about the writer, Jeff Chang. For anybody who doesn't know, he wrote this amazing book, Can't Stop, Won't Stop. It's about the history of hip hop, but really through a political lens, and about the political movements that were happening in the South Bronx that kind of coalesced with the cultural movements that were happening in hip hop. And actually, in the festival, we have a film, just intersections, just want to mention it, called The Third Coast by Susan Allen Raymond, who shot An American Family, the first reality TV series, and also The Police Tapes, which is this, you know, kind of searing documentary set in the backseats of police cars in the South Bronx in the late 70s. The experiences that were depicted in the police tapes were then taken, and that became basically, extensively, Fort Apache, the Bronx, which then many members of the community in the South Bronx really took offense to and felt was like a really hostile representation of their community. And Jeff Chang's book breaks this all down and shows how this kind of dovetails with hip-hop history. So amazing writer, amazing book, amazing person to be collaborating with. Just want to shout out that book. If you're not familiar with it, it's incredible and really connects up to, I think, your work in terms of thinking about these intersections of art and culture and politics and experience and how these things come together. So with that in mind, your new project, the final new project, talk to us.
Yeah, I mean, you know, as we're talking about it, you know, and kind of, you know, I'm adding to what you just mentioned is this idea of, in filmmaking, it's true, I do want to have some kind of impact, right, in terms of films. And I think when we think of impact, we think of like, you know, oh, can we change a law? Can we, you know, change some kind of policy? But realistically, impact can look like narrative change, right? Like this idea of who do we think someone is, or who do we see ourselves as? Like the 20 by 20 has that saying, like, see it to be it, right? This idea of like when Obama became president, how many young kids suddenly think they can become president, right? Like these ideas. So I've lately gotten really kind of invested in some of these ideas of narrative change, right? And thinking about that. So as I mentioned earlier, I was interested in, you know, starting to look more in Texas. So one of the projects, I've been working on several projects, and one of the projects that I've been working on during COVID is this series called Capua Stories, which we're going to see a little teaser of, which is something that I'm still working on. But as I was, screening a lot of my films over the past years, I've started noticing, specifically in Filipino-American communities, that I would meet these amazing organizers who, really activating communities and outspoken, and then them telling me that they have a lot of political differences with their families, or, you know, their families don't quite understand what they do because they don't really want to push it, and this respect for the elders, you know, and all this kind of stuff.
But all that stuff is changing, right?
So I started thinking about creating a project that would be a portrait of different Filipino Americans and kind of how they're bridging, in my opinion, is kind of bridging these divides between them and their parents and between generations. I got some funding and I was about to make it, and then COVID hit, right? And as we know, the world has changed and is not going back. But I didn't stop the project, I just kind of changed it, and it became a project that I started experimenting a more collaborative, I would say, project where I'm collaborating with the actual people in the documentaries. And so the first, the first wave of this project is I documented three stories in Texas, all women, one who's actually here in Houston, Jenna Maravilla, who you'll meet briefly, and two other women in, one in Austin, who comes from Fort Worth, and one who's in Austin. And so we're going to see a teaser of that, and it's called Capua Stories.
This is a prayer and a reminder. All we have is now. Anak, umuwi ka na.
Remember when you started going to college? You came home a liberal?
Okay.
That's how they brainwash people.
I'm not brainwashed. They're trying to support me in ways that are new to them.
I know you have concerns. Is part of it my activism?
Yeah, it's more dangerous to your life.
The way that our family communicates is not necessarily, it's not great.
So what advice would you give for those of us that are struggling with mental health?
Deal with it.
I think the norm for our community so far has been to just like stay silent and like keep to your own business. In order for a subject to not be taboo in our community, there always has to be like someone to start that conversation. Yeah.
You speak up for me when I can't speak up for myself. And I've seen you do that for other people.
I mean, I love my parents and I want to play the long-term game.
Aww.
So this is a series that, I did the first stage of it in Texas, and there's three stories in Texas, and right now I'm filming three stories in Queens, actually. And then the idea would be I'm going to do the rest. I'm going to go to the Midwest after that and then maybe make my way to the West Coast and just kind of do this kind of national story look. And they're all looking at different phases, right? So the first three stories that we're looking at are occurring as the shutdowns are happening and George Floyd, is murdered and, the kind of, what some people call is the summer of racial reckoning, happening. And then with Queens, I'm starting to move into this idea of people trying to move on with their lives but are working in these kind of essential worker fields, right? And what does that kind of look like? And so it'll be a project that's ongoing for the next year or so.
I'm so excited for this project.
Anna, thank you.
It's so incredible. And your partner on it is one of the producers of Yellow Rose,
yeah,
right?
Cecilia Mejia.
Yeah, one of the producers of Yellow Rose, which we showed in the Houston Smart Arts Festival 2019 about a Filipino country singer at the age of, what was she, 15 or little kid. So, more connections there. Do we have any other questions?
It's always a challenge to me when I edit what not to include, what to include. And it is, like, for features, you always shoot more than you're going to use, but sometimes it's really torturous trying to figure out what you're going to leave out to make the overall a tighter narrative. So can you speak to, like, how do you make those choices for shorts, like the ones you did before, as well as the features?
Yeah, in a lot of ways, making shorts are really challenging because you don't have the luxury of time, and
it's like writing a short story.
It's like writing a short story, right? So you just have to contain it in a certain way. So sometimes I just think about, what is the idea, and the idea might be too big for a short film. If it can lend itself to, rather than look at a year, can you look at a day, rather than look at a whole night, can you look at a moment, right? And I do think trying to scale it for me has been the way to kind of do it. And speaking as someone who does teach, it's interesting, right? Because all the students make shorts and a lot of them watch features, and I try to tell them, like, okay, you have to think about how to pivot in your brain because you're actually looking at a different structure and try to contain it. So, but you're right, it's like there's so much material sometimes, right? So it can be really challenging for a short film.
Any other questions?
Have you written any textbooks?
Have I written any textbooks?
That's next.
No,
the PJ Raval textbook.
No, I don't think. I don't
it
think
would
I
have the
could,
best like textbook
yeah,
photo
totally, yeah.
like ever.
It would be an instructional manual. Yeah.
Your picture on the.
No, I have not. But who knows, right? Can't outrule anything. Like, why not? Maybe one day.
That would be great. I hope you write a textbook. What a great idea.
Yeah. So I have a uncle who's gay, who I asked him recently if he would start doing Zoom recorded meetings about his life with me. And I'm getting, you know, a positive reaction, but a little bit of hesitance. Like, he just can't figure out the technology of how to get the camera to work on his computer. That kind of thing. So, what advice do you have for getting a that generation to feel more, I don't know, to feel more open to the whole experience? Because there's definitely a, you know, my generation is definitely more open about, you know, in our time. And he's, you know, now he really is a senior citizen. He's in his 80s, so. And he's alone in a house, especially with COVID.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, with this last project that I showed a teaser for, you know, a lot of it is self-documented. And I thought a lot about it just how people are telling their stories already. Right. So for some, especially these younger generations, right, a lot of it is on social media. There's a lot of posting that they're doing, a lot of, you know, selfies. But I would start with what are they comfortable with, right? And maybe it's not Zoom, maybe it's a phone call, you know, and what does that look like? Maybe just have a phone call with them. And if they're open to you recording that, then maybe that's where it can start, right? Like trying to incorporate ways that they're already storytelling that they might not even recognize as storytelling, right? And so maybe it's that, right? And not having to force any technology upon and maybe start introducing. But if you do want to start introducing, then I would also recommend doing some tutorials, right? Like create some guides, walk them through it, you know, get on the phone with
them. You need PJ's textbook. You need PJ's Zoom textbook.
The textbook. And in a strange way, I did. With this last project, I created these like little tutorial guides for each person was like, yeah, this is how I want you to record on the Zoom, or, you know, I know you're shooting things on your iPhone, but can you, you know, use this microphone and plug it in this way, you know, those kinds of things. But certainly with, you know, technology is different and, you know, with different generations. So I would say just start with what they're already using, right? So.
Nice. That's good advice. Any closing thoughts? Anything you want to share?
No, just that, you know, it's been a pleasure doing this because rarely do I get a chance to reflect. And this really has been, I mean, the first film that we started with, I started filming in 2004. And as I mentioned, I had presented something here, but that was when it was all short narrative films and experimental. So this has kind of been like, you know, what I've done since. And it's kind of, you know, what I will say is I am a work in progress, right? And so it's kind of interesting to see the film trajectories and think about how much I've grown also, you know, in the process of making these films. And I've grown because I've made these films, right? It's part of my life experience. So even though these films are about other people, they strangely are about me because I was there, you know, for each of them. So I almost look at these as markers in my life in a strange way. Like, the first film I made that was, you know, me really, you know, getting to know a friend really well, you know, my now husband, helped me with the second film, and that really kind of brought us together. And, you know, when I even look at Call Her Gunda, I really think about how I've really had this kind of you know, kind of like awakening in terms of who,
well,
you know,
you on a panel and they were
now.
Like, you need to make a film. About
yeah, it was.
You were on a panel and they were like, you make a film
yeah,
about
make
it.
Make a film
like,
about
okay.
this. And I was like, I don't know if I can make a film about this. And then, and thinking yeah. about how I eventually did. Right. And feeling that I had the, you know, confidence to do something like that where I would not have, you know, maybe earlier on. Yeah. So it's kind of, you know, it's making me feel a little bit older in a good way. But yeah, but thank you so much for, you know.
Full of wisdom and grace. It is always a pleasure, PJ. Thank you
so much.
Thank you so much, audience. Thanks, PJ.
Thanks.